T'es sûr?
Non. Vas-y, ici. Voilà.
Okay, that's been found. So, good morning, everyone. I think we can start if you agree, Alejandro.
Go ahead.
Perfect. So, good morning to everyone, and I will start presenting myself. So, for the one that was not here yesterday, I'm Teo Lombardo, a PhD student of the Artistic Project since October 2019, and today we speak about a different subject respect the one of yesterday, and particularly about the use of physical-based modeling and machine learning to get inside the lithium battery manufacturing. I will focus mainly in my presentation in one step of manufacturing, one phase, as we will see in a second. So, in general, manufacturing is a complex process that relies on different procedures, different processes. As first, we start with our components, so the active material, the conductive additive, the binder, the solvent. We mix them in order to obtain a slurry. Typically, we work in this way. We coat the slurry in a current collector. We dry the slurry in an oven in a way to remove all the solvent. And in this way, we can obtain a dried electrode that can be further compressed through the calender in order to achieve lower porosity. Now, I will not get into detail in the effect of calendering that we mainly spoke about that yesterday, and Alan Ganjong will speak about this also in the afternoon. In this presentation, I will speak about the slurry phase, particularly because this is a phase that is known. You can see some examples here of papers that impacts significantly the performance and the properties of the electrode, but it's typically the less studied phase, and especially from a modeling point of view, is typically neglected. So, in terms of modeling community, we normally focus on the electrode, but there are not so many examples of articles, scientific articles, in terms of modeling that deals with the slurry phase. So, in this presentation, I will divide this presentation into main part. The first one about physics-based modeling in terms of slurry, and the second one of machine learning models by using experimental results. So we'll start with the first part in terms of physics-based modeling. With this slide, I want to give you an overview of the approach that we use here to model the slurry. Particularly, we focus up to now our attention to this kind of chemistry. So we use NMC111, carbon black as active material, obviously, carbon black as conductive additive, PVDF as binder, and MP as solvent. And I would like to let you focus on this square here, in which I reported the typical dimension of this particle or molecule, and you can see that you have different order of magnitude of differences because the NMC particle are typically in the order of micrometer or tens of micrometer, carbon black in terms of tens of nanometer, and PVDF and MP are molecules, so we're in the order of nanometer. And that, in terms of modeling, creates a problem that is quite obvious because if you want to model such kind of system in a way that is representative of the reality, you need a simulation box that is big, at least some tens of micrometers, considering the dimension of the active material particle. However, if you use a simulation box of this dimension and you try to fulfill it with particle that has this dimension, so in the order of nanometer or tens of nanometer, you will come out with an enormous amount of particle that is computationally inaccessible today. So we need to find an approximation that allow us to simulate the system without considering particles so small as the dimension that we have here. So how we solve this problem? Particularly in our case, we use mainly two kind of particle. From one side, we have the active material particle. In that sense, we use the dimension that we found experimentally. In particular, we use several dimension of active material particles following the experimental particle size distribution that we can see here on the bottom right, that was achieved experimentally through SEM measurements. While we use an effective particle that is called carbon binder domain, and it's represented in here, to solve this problem of dimension. Particularly, the carbon binder domain is an effective particle that contains inside the carbon black, the binder, and in the case of the slurry, also the solvent. In this way, we can model the system with an effective particle that has dimension comparable to the active material ones, in a way to have a computational cost that is accessible. In particular, now in this presentation, I will just speak about the slurry, so we'll always have the solvent inside the carbon binder domain particle. But as Alan Ganjong will show in the afterward, in the afternoon, I think at 3:40, to simulate after that we obtain the correct slurry structure, the dried electron, and then the calendaring, we shrunk the CVD particles by removing the solvent, actually. So at the end, we will have only carbon black and binder for the solid carbon binder domain particle. But now let's focus again on the slurry. In particular, here some general information about the kind of simulation that we perform. We use a software, LAMMPS, that is an open source molecular dynamics software. In particular, here to model the slurry, we use coarse grain molecular dynamics simulation, coarse grain in the sense that obviously we use a coarse grain particle that is a carbon binder domain. We apply periodic boundary condition on all the directions, so x, y, and z, and we use a combination of two force fields that are the granular Hertzian to mimic the mechanical property of the system, and the Lennard-Jones to mimic the adhesive forces that we have in the slurry. We also follow the experimental composition in terms of ratio between active material and carbon binder, and we follow also the, as I said just one moment ago, the experimental particle size distribution for the active material. However, this simulation obviously has several parameters that are the parameter of the force field, and the validity of the use of these two force field as the correctness of the parameter that we use should be validated in some way, in particular comparing the result that we can get by the modeling to the results that we can get experimentally. And in that sense, our main observable is the viscosity. Particularly, we can measure experimentally the viscosity through rheological measurement, and we can do the same kind of experiments in silico, in particular it's the non-equilibrium molecular dynamics, coarse-grain molecular dynamics, in this case, simulation and workflow to obtain the viscosity is represented here. Particularly, we start from our slurry structure. We apply a shear rate, so a force to make shear this. We can calculate the shear stress as output, so the force that fits the structure as a function of the shear rate that we apply. And knowing this information, the shear rate and the shear stress, we can then calculate the viscosity for that specific shear rate. And then we can build point by point the shear viscosity curve that I represent here on the right and compare it directly to the experiments. Here there is an example, for instance, in which we have a good matching between the experimental and simulated result. In that case, we can say that the parametrization and the approximation that we made by using and by choosing this force field are correct, and then the slurry structure that we obtain is representative of the real ones. So now let's start with some first results. Particularly here, I report the different shear viscosity curve for different condition of interest, in particular different composition. As you can see, 96% of active material in a weight ratio of 95%, and for different solid content. So for different ratio between the mass of the solid content, or solid particle, active material, carbon, and binder added as powder, and the mass of the solvent, so respect the difference respect the liquid one, at least the NMP. In this case, we can see that we can obtain a pretty good matching between the modeling and the experimental results for all the conditions analyzed, so for all the solid content and composition. And I would like also to underline that in the meantime, with the same force field parameter, we also check that the density of the slurry is, let's say, we can obtain a simulated density of the slurry that match the experimental one that I report here on the right. So from this, we can be quite sure that the model works and is representative of the reality, because with a specific set of parameters values, we are matching for each of these conditions both the shear viscosity curve, that is really important also for the coating step afterward, and the slurry density. So that's very nice. However, there is a main drawback of this approach, is the computational cost. Because to give you an idea, the parametrization of such curve took, at least from my side, several months of work dedicated almost only to this. So the computational cost is really important. In that sense, then we try to develop computational tools in order to accelerate the parametrization of such model, and particularly the algorithm that we developed as based on particle swarm optimization theory, that now I will try to explain to you as best as I can for the case study of our simulation. particularly, let's consider that we need to optimize just two parameters. So we are in a parameter space of two dimensions, parameter one, parameter two. We have different points in this parameter space, okay? Each of these points we can associate for taking the coordinate a certain value of both the parameter, parameter one and parameter two, okay? Then we can associate this parameter value to a certain simulation in terms of the slurry. We can launch the simulation, and once that we get the result, we can assess the correctness of this slurry structure obtained with this set of parameters by comparing the result that we can get from it to the experimental results. In particular, to do so, we use a cost function that is very easy, you can see it here, that compare the experimental and computational results. Then our goal in the procedure that I will describe in a moment is to minimize the cost function, in particular to obtain possibly a cost function equal to zero, that in terms will mean that the computational results are exactly equal respect the modeling ones. So now I will start explaining how particle swarm optimization applied to our case works, but just a small parenthesis of nomenclature. In order to be coherent with the nomenclature of particle swarm optimization, from now on I will call the point that you can see here as particle, in order to be coherent with the classical use nomenclature. So let's say that this first particle, the position of this first particle, has been selected randomly. Okay, so we have some results. We launch our simulation. We can compare it to the experimental results. At this point, we should move the position of this particle in the parameter space in a way to try to find the zone of this parameter space in which we minimize the cost function. Then, you know, actually, in other words, to optimize the parameterization to find the parameter value that match the experimental results. How we do that? So let's consider that at the beginning we associate to each particle a random velocity. The velocity here is defined as a vector that tells you where it will be the position of a certain particle, where a certain particle will move from the iteration e to the iteration e plus one. In order to move this particle, however, we don't base our choice only it's fine. Okay, so it was a shift of the screen. So as was saying, we don't base the movement of this particle only on the random generated vector, obviously. But now I will show you how we do exactly. So let's place a case study of one particle. We focus only on this, and let's consider that between these four particles, the one that has given the best results, so the one that for which we obtain the lowest cost function, is the one reported here in green. So we can then build a vector linking this yellow particle to the green one. We can do the vector sum of this blue and red vector. We obtain this purple one, and this will be the velocity vector that will make move the particle, in particular the yellow particle here, from the iteration e to the iteration e plus one, as I show you here. So for the other two particles, the procedure is exactly the same. So we have a certain random velocity. We can build the vector that link this particle to the one for which we obtain the best result. We do the sum of the two vectors, and we move the particle. For the particle for which we obtain the best result, at this point we have only the random generated vector, and then it will move accordingly. At this point, we move our particle, and I would like to underline that we move our particle in a region of space for which we obtain the lowest value of cost function. And this is exactly the principle behind the particle swarm optimization, so that the particle will follow the one, so the swarm of particle will follow the one that obtain the best results, in this case the lowest value of cost function. Then we can again select the new parameters value, launch other, in this case, four simulation, assess the results compared to the experimental result, and then the loops start again. So now let's go to see a bit the results. Here I report the curve that we obtained from a classical particle swarm optimization approach based on our case study. And we can see that at the beginning, the cost function decreased quite significantly and quite fastly. Just to give you an order of time, one iteration here, it took for the computational resources that we use around 36 hours, so it's much faster than the manual optimization. However, it was not actually after around 10 iterations, it found a local minima, it was not really able to escape from it. In that sense, we tried to improve even more this algorithm in order to achieve better results and a faster optimization. In particular, we developed two main approaches. The first approach is the human-driven PSO. How does it work? Particularly, when we run some simulation, the simulation will generate data, either that the simulation are generated through the PSO procedure, either that they are launched manually. This result can be analyzed by a Newman operator that can then try to predict which are the parameters value that most likely will give a good result, something that is similar to the experimental one. And then if the human operator is good enough, we'll offer to the algorithm a set of parameters, then a region of space of this parameter space that is most interesting. This is the most interesting one, because in that region we will find the lowest value of the cost function. In that sense, the other particle then will follow it and then will focus their attention in analyzing the cost function that we obtain by using parameter in this region of space that is most likely the most interesting one for our parameterization. Another approach is based on a similar idea, so is to use the data we generate either manually, either from PSO, not to learn from it in terms of humans, but to train a machine learning algorithm that can then try to predict the parameters value that would most likely give a better result than respect the random one selected at the beginning from the PSO, and then the other particle, again, will follow this choice and will analyze in more detail the region of space indicated by, in this case, the machine learning algorithm. So here in this slide, I report just a scheme to compare the two approaches to understand one small difference that up to now I didn't discuss, and after we'll go to the results. So here in the scheme A, I report the procedure for the human-driven PSO, while in B, the machine learning-driven one. And the difference that I would like to underline is that for the human-driven, the human operator is able to give an information to the PSO algorithm only to the first iteration, so at the beginning of the optimization, while afterward the position of each particle, the parameter space, is dictated by the particle form optimization algorithm, as I described in the first slide before. From the side of machine learning, we have an intrinsic advantage in that sense, because we can automatically update for each iteration of the particle form optimization the dataset that we use for the training and for the test with the new results. Then the machine learning, iteration by iteration, can predict a new position of the particle that for the machine learning algorithm will give the best results, so the low evaluation function. And then we can use the potential of machine learning algorithm up from the beginning up to the end of the optimization. In particular, the idea of behind these two approach and their comparison was twofold. From one side, as I said, to try to improve and accelerate the parameterization of a classical PSO algorithm in our simulation. And the second reason was to try to compare the efficiency in terms of accelerating the parameterization from a human-driven, so a PSO driven by a human operator with a certain degree of expertise, particularly when we developed this code, it was already some months that I work on the parameterization, so I started to be a bit expert on this kind of simulation, and compare it to the results that we can get from a machine learning algorithm that obviously works automatically without the need of any expertise from the operator. So in this slide, I report the result that we get from human-driven, machine learning-driven PSO. I compare them to the previous one, the one that we get with the classical PSO algorithm. And we can see that the results are much better. We reach quite fastly a good parameter value. So we reach an evaluation function approximately equal to zero. In particular, we can also see that respect human-driven, machine learning-driven algorithm, we obtain comparable results. That actually means that in our case, the machine learning algorithm was able to reproduce SQL in an automatic way the work performed and the information given to the algorithm by an expert operator. So here I will give some conclusion about this first part, so the one devoted to machine learning algorithm for the for the physical based modeling for the slurry phase. In particular, I illustrate our computational approach, at least for the slurry phase. For the electron and calendaring, it will be done by Alan this afternoon. I also show the validation of our physics-based modeling, mimicking NC-based slurry, and we did it for different solid contents and different composition by comparing the experimental and modeled viscosity, shear viscosity curve, and density. And we also developed several optimization algorithms based on particle swarm optimization theory that actually allow to speed up the parametrization significantly. So now I will move to the second part of my talk, in particular the one devoted to a machine learning algorithm combined with experimental results to analyze the effect of slurry on manufacturing. In particular, first I would like to give a brief idea to the not expert one of how machine learning algorithm works. So typically we start from some data. Machine learning is a data-driven method, so we need some data, either for experiment, either for modeling, either for something, but we need data. Typically we divide this data into groups. The training set, typically the 80% of the data set, the initial data set, and the test set, 20%, typically. At this point we can use the training set to train our machine learning algorithm. There are several of them. For instance, the one that we use for the particle swarm optimization is deep neural network. Here we show another kind of approach. Through this training, the machine learning algorithm will build a certain model, and then the result of this model, so its predictive capability in terms of what it will be the output respect to a certain input, can be compared to the data that we have in the test set that was not used for the training. Then we can compare these two results, and if the predicted value are almost equal to the true one, so if these points are approximately in this blue curve that is the first bisector, then we can assess that and we can also quantify the prediction accuracy of the machine learning model, and then if the prediction accuracy is high enough, we can use it for further prediction. So there are anyway different machine learning approach. One approach is, for instance, unsupervised classification. How does it work? Typically, we start from our data set. We don't give any particular information to our machine learning algorithm that will try, as a function of their common properties, to classify in different group the data that we have in the data set. At this point, it's up to the operator to understand the physical meaning or the chemical meaning behind this group, because the only work that the machine learning does is to find the group and the limit region of the group, but does not give any insight on the physical or chemical meaning of these groups. Another approach is supervised classification. That means that we associate to each data a certain class label. So at this point, we exactly know the physical or chemical meaning of this class because it was given by us. And the algorithm will define the limit of the space in which most likely we'll find so if we have new data, for instance, if we have a new data that is placed here, we can assess that with a certain probability as a function of the prediction accuracy of the model, the new data is part of the red group, okay? A priori of what this means in terms of physics and chemistry. Another approach is regression. So we can see this as a, let's say, complicated fitting. In particular, it's a model that giving a certain numerical inputs, it outputs the numerical output or outputs as a function of how it was built, the model. In our case, in the work that I'm going to present, we work on supervised classification, because actually it can be a good choice when the dimension of your data set is not enormous. In the work that I'm going to present you, we use 82 different experimental data points. Each data point was measured, is the average of different measurements, so we were quite confident on the statistical correctness of this data, but still 82 data points for a machine learning algorithm is quite low. However, with a super fine classification algorithm, we were able, and we were also happy and surprised of that, to obtain kind of good prediction accuracy in the order of 80%. So now I will, with this scheme, I would like to show you a bit the workflow that we follow for this this study to go afterward to the results. So particularly we start from the experimental data, experiment analysis. In particular, we focus our attention on the effect of the slurry properties, and particularly the composition, the content of active material. We maintain, as we can see here, the constant the mass ratio between binder and carbon, maintaining constant to one. We play also with the mass ratio, which is the solid component and the liquid one, or the slurry, and the viscosity of the slurry at the shear rate applied during the coating. We wanted then to see the effect of this property, these slurry properties, on certain key electrode properties as the mass loading and the porosity. Maintaining constant other parameters, as I already said, the mass ratio between binder and carbon, the chemistry, we work also here with an NC111, and the drying condition. Then, in this case, afterward, we built our dataset experimentally, and we need to assign to each data a certain class, as I said, for the supervised classification algorithm. And particularly, here with this table, we give you the limit that we gave to each class. For instance, for the mass loading, for us, a low mass loading in this case is between 5 and 20, actually lower than 20, medium between 20 and 35, and high higher than 35, actually. Why we gave and how we chosen this value, actually they were chosen in a way to have approximately the same number of data for each of this class, low, medium, and high, for both mass loading and porosity. Then, now that we have our data set, we can use it to train and test the machine learning algorithm. We can build a model, and then we can check the result of this model, compare it to the experiments, and compare it to understand if we predict the same things, or if we can have some more insight thanks to machine learning or not. And now I will show you that actually in our case it was possible to have some more insight thanks to machine learning. So I will start from the easiest case, that is the mass loading. Particularly here on the left, you see the result that we obtain through machine learning, particularly from by using the support vector machine model. We benchmarked actually different kind of machine learning algorithm, in particular random forest, support vector machine, deep neural network, and the one that we chose, support vector machine, it was chosen for its higher predictive accuracy in our case study, and also because of its capability to give some really easy to read maps that can then be used for also a not expert operator. And particularly we compare the result to the experimental, raw experimental data. In this case, for the mass loading. So what we can see, let's start from the support vector machine. In particular, here you can see that the regional space are divided in three different colors that are the three classes. Particularly, the white one is the low mass loading in this case, the purple the medium, and light blue high mass loading. Then the things that we can see is that by increasing the amount of active material, we increase the mass loading. Actually, the light blue zone of this piece of the space increase, that is kind of obvious because obviously you will increase the amount of active material in your system. But we also see that increasing the viscosity and the amount of solid particle, we have respectively an increase of the mass loading and a decrease of the latter. If we go to the raw experimental results, actually in this case we can see approximately the same kind of trend. Particularly, we can see, for instance, here that the mass loading increased by increasing the viscosity, and similarly, we can also see the effect of the amount of content of the active material amount. So, in this first case study, it was relatively easy. We can see that the machine learning algorithm predicts correctly the trend that we can observe experimentally, even if at this stage, the machine learning algorithm didn't give any added insight on the results, because these trends are perfectly observable also by using the raw experimental result without using any machine learning algorithm. Now, before to go to the porosity, in which we will see that is not exactly the case, in which the machine learning algorithm give some more insight, we can, before to do that, ask if we can understand the reason behind this trend, and particularly we can explain them. if we go to analyze the shear viscosity curve and the coating process. So particularly here, we can see that in a shear viscosity curve, when we go from a certain viscosity to a lower viscosity, we start from that, we actually, for the same system, so we maintain, for instance, in this black curve, we are applying a higher shear rate. However, the shear rate is linked to both the coat speed and the comma gap, so the gap in which you the slurry pass through to be coated on the current collector, in this case aluminum. In this case, experimentally, we maintain constant the line load. So actually, to increase the shear rate, it means to decrease the comma gap. In that sense, we have a direct relationship with the mass loading. Another effect is the effect of the amount of solid particle that we have in the system, and particularly if now we compare the three curves here, the black, the red, and the blue one, for which we have an incremental amount of solid particles, we can see that applying a certain constant viscosity, remember that when we analyze the results in terms of, for instance, supportive vector machine, we compare for a certain viscosity value the effect of the amount of solid particle, for instance. In this case, we see that, again, applying the same viscosity, considering the shift of the shear viscosity curve, adding a more important amount of solid particle, we are, again, applying higher shear rate, and then we are playing with the comma gap that impacts, obviously, the mass loading. So, in this case, for the mass loading, we can obtain more or less the same trends using both the raw experimental data and the support vector machine algorithm, and we can explain this trend. Now we will go to a bit more complicated case scenario, that is the porosity, and particularly from, in this case, we will start from the raw experimental data, and as you can clearly see, we don't have any trend. So experimentally, we cannot really see the effect of the amount of the composition, of the amount of solid particle, the viscosity. We can, actually, they are just scattered data, we can say nothing about them. However, if we go on the supportive vector machine model, we can still see a trend. And particularly, we can see this low mass loading region, the white region here, that appears by increasing the amount of active material by at a high amount of solid particle and high viscosity. So, as first, this is nice because it means that with machine learning we can see something more, but we should wonder if the things that we are observing with machine learning is correct, or it's just an error of the model. To check this, actually, we use an independent analysis, particularly by using oscillatory experiments that will be covered much more in detail tomorrow by Emiliano Primo. And actually, we can observe through these analysis that give information about the elastic and plastic behavior of your slurry, that this trend is physically explainable because as a function of the solid content, as a function of the composition, you will obtain a solid-like or liquid-like behavior of your slurry that then will make it more or less compactable during the coating, that then it will impact after the evaporation, obviously the porosity. Then in that sense, thanks to support vector machine, then to machine learning in this case, we can actually find some trend that was not possible to see through other classical analysis method, as it could be, for instance, just plotting the raw experimental results. So now I will go to the conclusion of also this second part, in particular for the machine learning. I show you that machine learning can be used to understand the interdependencies between manufacturing parameters, in this case the slurry properties and electro properties, as mass loading and porosity. And we also found that machine learning, in this case combining with experimental data, actually can disclose trends that are not accessible by using other analysis method, as it was for the case of the electroporosity. And then with this, I thank you all really for your attention, and if there is any question, I will be happy to reply.
Thank you.
So now
thank
I will you. Check.
Thank you very question. Much, Leo. You have several questions.
Yeah, apparently there is a lot of questions, so I will start from the bottom. Most likely thank I will, if Alejandro and Mark agree, I will reply here to some of the questions, and after we reply to the others in the chat,
to avoid taking much time
from the next speakers. So
you have still
the first one is from Diana. the task which model you use for the viscosity calculation in lumps. So actually we use non equilibrium coarse grain molecular dynamics. It means that we use the same force field, but we can apply a deformation on our simulation box. Okay, so we apply a shear forces actually, and we measure the forces that that the particle feels as a function of this shear stress that we applied, is a function of this, as I show in the scheme here that I can find again. One second. It's a bit far. Okay, bug. Anyway, okay. Okay, in this scheme here, so we can apply non-equilibrium molecular dynamics, exactly same model here, same parameters value, same force field, same everything, but we allow then the system to apply a certain shear force to deform the system. We calculate the forces that the particle feels as a function of the shear rate that you applied, and then we can directly calculate the viscosity. So the second question is, which model you use for the study? This is something that I say here, more or less, is a coarse grain molecular dynamics model, so it's based on molecular dynamics, in which we use this force field, so granular Hertz and Lennard-Jones. If you go to the LAMPS home page, if you want, I can put it after in a comment for your question. I can send you the links. You can find all the detail on this force field, and maybe Alan will also speak about it. And that actually, you can with the periodic boundary condition and this force field, after you can generate your system for the experimental composition, particle size distribution, and that's it. You have your simulation. Anyway, in the article that we publish for this work, there is the reference in the presentation. In any case, I can add it. In the support information, there are all the details on the model and electrode generation. So you can find it there, all the information that you want. So we reply to maybe other two questions, and after I will give space to Elizabeth. So what was the motivation to use granular Hertz along with Lennard-Jones? So what is the correction it provides? Actually, Lennard-Jones, obviously, it's quite easy, quite simple as force field. In that case, we can try to use it to mimic a bit the adhesive forces, but in a discrete system as battery, in general, also slurry, we have an important contribution of mechanical properties of the system. As we will see, this is critical for calendaring, as Alan will present. In that sense, granular Hertzian give you exactly the possibility to play with the mechanical property, to define the mechanical property of your system. So it's needed for that reason. So I'll reply to another one. Is the viscosity shear rate dependent? Is your fluid lipotoxin related? Your simulation, the viscosity is definitely shear rate dependent, as is the function of the temperature. For instance, all the result that I show here is for 25 degrees. After, it can be dependent of the shear rate in different way. You can have shear thickening or shear thinning behavior. That means that the viscosity increase or decrease respectively by applying higher shear rate. I'm sure that Emiliano will give a lot of detail on that. So follow the speak of Emiliano tomorrow, and we will have much more detail than what I can offer to you. So maybe I can stop Theo, here. I don't know, Mark, I see Alejandro.
Theo,
reply to the other question in the chat. I don't know
can you hear
you
me?
Think.
Can you hear me, Theo?
If
yes.
Not, I can
yes.
continue. No problem.
Theo, you hear me? Yes.
Mark, Alejandro?
Yes.
I think Theo is not hearing you.
Okay, for some reason, but you heard me, right, Mark? Yes. Okay, so what I'm saying is that we still have 5 minutes.
In any case, I can continue to reply
some,
in this case.
Some 5 minutes, yes.
So there is Yvonne and Marcelina that ask, is there any chemical reaction happening in slurry that might affect the performance? In our case, no. In our chemical system, no. If you are in a system in which some chemical reaction can occur, obviously, you should consider it. In our case, our model is based more on physics than chemistry, and the main reason behind it is that we like to have models that are as much as possible chemical neutral, in order to be able to adapt our model to other similar chemistry, for instance, to nickel cobalt aluminium or other oxide, for instance. So What is the rush of material to a solvent? Moment, I open it because I don't see it very well. What is the rush of material to a solvent, material MP, which is maintained to the good viscosity both experiment and simulation? So in terms of comparison, we compare experimental conditions that are meaningful for the manufacturing. So in particular, the range of shear rate that we analyze is the range of shear rate that is of interest for industrial application, and the composition and solid content we analyze is something that could be of interest, and it's a slurry that allow to obtain good coating, good electrode. In that sense, the solid content should be tuned as a function of the property that you want to get, as I show in for the machine learning part. It has an impact on the properties, and you always need also to remember that, but again, this will be a part that Emiliano will speak about. You need to have a good processability, so you need to be able to coat your slurry, but you also need to have a low enough viscosity in order to have a solid particle suspension. But again, if you follow the speech of Emiliano, you will have much more detail in that sense. Yeah, Mark, I don't know if you want to give space to Elizabeth, maybe.
We cover two minutes, and then we move to Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, if you are ready and if you want to continue, I can continue to reply.
Sorry, maybe I entered too early. Sorry.
No. I think it's Elizabeth. It's fine. Normally, I have just another 3 minutes, so I can give it to you if you want. It's Elizabeth. Perfectly fine. So if you want, I can remove to stop the sharing and continue to reply on the chat, as you prefer.
So, Eddie, can you hear me?
If you need 2 minutes more, I will continue to reply.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. I think Theo doesn't hear me.
Okay. So I will stop. So good presentation.
Okay, it's fine. So thanks, Theo. Thanks a lot. I don't know if you...